भद्रं कर्णेभि
भद्रं कर्णेभि
श्रुणुयाम देवा
श्रुणुयाम देवा
भद्रं पश्येम
भद्रं पश्येम
अक्षभिर्यजत्राः
अक्षभिर्यजत्राः
स्थिरैः
स्थिरैः
अङ्गैः
अङ्गैः
तुष्टुवां
तुष्टुवां
सस्तनूभिः
सस्तनूभिः
व्यशेम
यशेम
देवहितं
देवहितं
यदायुः
यदा
ॐ
ॐ
शांति
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 हरि ओम
हरि
So we were seeing the invocation of Shankaracharya before his commentary starts. So in that we had seen the first stanza. Now we see the second stanza. Yo Vishvatma Vidija Vishayan Prashya Bhogan Sthavishtan Paschatcha Anyan Swamati Vibhavan Jyotisha Swena Sukshman सर्वान् एतान् पुनरपि शनैः स्वात्मनि स्थापयित्वा हित्वा सर्वान् विशेषान् वितगुणगणः विशेषान्वित विशेषान् विगतगुणगणः पाश्वसौ नस्तुरियः सो तुरियः द मे दैट तुरिया तुरिया इज द फोर्थ स्टेट और द ट्रू स्टेट ऑफ अवर रियलिटी our nature. So may that Turiya, what should Turiya do? Turiya through Maya, because we are all living in a ignorant realm of Maya. Vishvatma Vidija Vishayan Prashya Bhogan Sthavishtva Sthavishtan. So may that Turiya, having identified itself as Vishvatma, having identified itself as the entire universe, in the waking state, what should it do? Vidija Vishayan Prashya. It should experience different kinds of manifold Vishayan, gross objects of enjoyment, bhogan sthavishthan. Through, how can you enter into objects of enjoyment? By ignorance, because it is only in ignorance that we see or experience objects of enjoyment, and also not only enjoyment but also of attachment. Let it get into these objects, and also Paschat cha anyan. Also, in the dream state, afterwards, in the dream state, let it swamati vibhavan jyotisha. See, when we close our eyes, there are no lights, but we see everything. How do we see? That is because of our own light. Light which is produced inside. It is not produced, means we are our own light. So we see. So, Swa Vibhavan Jyotisha, by one's own light, enlightened, what is seen? Sukshma, Svena Sukshman. You are seeing Svena Jyotisha, by one's own light, you are seeing Sukshman, you are seeing subtle things. Because in dream, there is no space. You are seeing an elephant in dream. Where did this elephant come from? In your body, elephant cannot come. But in dream, you are seeing elephant. Also, there is no time. In dream, 2 minutes dream, you are seeing 1 day's, or even worse, you are seeing 1 week's happenings. In two minutes dream, you will suddenly see 1 week happening has happened. How is it possible? Or also geographically, in dream, you are seeing you are going to New York and you are going to Washington DC talking to Donald Trump about his policies, etc. Because everyone can talk with the President of United States of America. So you do that and you come back. So, but then you get up and you see that you are sleeping. Maybe you are waiting for tea and tea did not come and you were sleeping. And in the meanwhile, you went and talked to Trump and everything and you came back. So that is what. So there is nothing in the gross form. It's everything is in subtle form. So through subtle form, O Turiya. So though Shankaracharya talks about Advaita Vedanta, he is an Advaitin, but still there is a kind of prayerfulness or kind of supplication, surrender in this hymn, because it says that, O Turiya, you do this, etc., etc. So what does it mean? Does it mean that Advaita Vedanta is not followed by Shankaracharya? No. Advaita Vedanta is propounded and he is an Advaitin. But it means that we have to constantly remember that it is the ultimate reality, Turiya. Very often we forget it. So that is why Shankaracharya is connecting it with our mundane experiences, day-to-day experiences. So day-to-day experiences, if we constantly remember that our true nature is Turiya and it is not this body and mind, if day-to-day experiences in the highs and falls or highs and lows of our life, if we remember this, then what will happen? You may suffer. Apparently your body and mind will suffer, but you will be anchored in the deep truth, in the highest reality. And so you will not be caught in the suffering. You will be able to come out of the suffering. So he says that, you see, in waking state, through gross objects of enjoyment and ignorance and attachment, you have identified yourself with the body, that Turiya. And in sleeping state, means in the dreaming state, you have your own, by your own light, you are identifying yourself with the subtle objects of Sukshman, subtle objects of enjoyment. Then Sarvan Etan Punarapi Shanaihi Swatmani Sthapayitva. And also all these objects of enjoyments, they are all brought into existence by whom? By Swatmani. They are brought into existence by yourself. This ignorance was created by whom? We don't know. It is beginningless. But can it be present if there was no ultimate reality? Can there be snake if there were no rope? Can there be this universe if there was no Brahman? No. Brahman is there and so universe is there. Rope is there and so snake is there. So without Brahman, this universe cannot exist. This universe is a different reading of Brahman. So that is what is said, that all these objects have been created, have been brought into existence by your own nature. And hitva sarvan visheshan vigata gunaganah. And so you have to what? You in dreamless sleep. So here you see, Mandukya Karika is a commentary on the Mandukya Upanishad, and Shankaracharya is now writing a commentary on both Mandukya Upanishad and Mandukya Karika. And what is the main focus of Mandukya Upanishad? Three states of consciousness. They are waking, dreaming and sleeping. And so you see how brilliance of Shankaracharya, that even in his invocation, in his Mangalacharana or in his Stuti, with which he starts the commentary, he brings into play these three states of consciousness. He talks about those three states of consciousness in this hymn itself, because that is what he will be talking about. That is what the Mandukya Upanishad talks about and the Mandukya Karika talks about. So he says, what does he say? Shanai swatmani sthapayitva hitva sarvan visheshan vigata gunaganah patu asau nah turiyah. So you see, you please patu means you please protect us like that. Patu means protect. Naha patu. Naha means us. So patu means protect. So protect. What turiya? Which is in gross form in the waking state through gross body and through attachment and ignorance we are experiencing. That turiya is experiencing this universe. In the dream state, it is experiencing subtle objects of enjoyment again through its own light. And in the dreamless state, what it does? Hitva sarvan visheshan. It withdraws. Hitva means actually to destroy. But here it means withdraws. It withdraws all objects. Sarvan visheshan. All objects. That is subtle object and also gross object. It withdraws itself into itself. It withdraws these objects into itself and becomes free. Vigata guna ganaha. It becomes free from all differences, all distinctions and all attributes. Sarvan visheshan. Visheshan means differences, distinction. And guna ganaha. All attributes. So it becomes free from vigata guna, differentiating characteristics, and also vishesha guna, these specific attributes. So it becomes free. So that turiya, which goes through these three states of consciousness, that turiya, let that turiya protect us. This is what has been told in the second stanza of the invocation. So is there any question at this point? Then Shankaracharya starts his commentary. He starts with the introduction to the Upanishads commentary and also Mandukya Karika's commentary. Mandukya Karika, as we know, was written by Gaudapada. Gaudapada was the guru's guru of Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya's guru was Govindapada and Govindapada's guru was Gaudapada. So he starts his commentary. He says, Om iti etat aksharam idam sarvam tasya upa vyakhyanam. So this is the first, these are the first three letters of the Upanishad itself. These are the first three letters of the Upanishad itself. Om iti etat aksharam idam sarvam tasya upa vyakhyanam. So that has been reproduced by Shankaracharya. He says that this Upanishad starts like that. What does it mean? Om iti etat aksharam idam. That is, Om iti etat aksharam idam. All this universe is etad aksharam, this letter Om. So Om in Sanskrit is actually one letter. Om in Sanskrit is actually one letter. O, you put, and you put one Chandra Bindu, it is called that, over it, that's all, that is Om. So Om etad aksharam idam. Iti etat aksharam idam. So this Om signifies all this. All this means this universe. This manifold universe. This universe which we see, manifest universe and manifold universe, is all signified by Om. Om. Sarvam tasya upavyakhyanam. Om iti etad aksharam idam sarvam. All this, sarvam means all this, is Om. This aksharam, this letter, is Om. Tasya upavyakhyanam. Now what we will do is, we will explain this letter. So all this universe is Om, Now we are going to explain this letter. That means what? If this universe is Om, and if you are going to explain that Om, that means you are going to explain the universe. Is it not? It naturally follows. Yes.
Maharaj, if the whole universe is like Om, then how it meant by symbolically or by sound?
So, like there is a seed of banyan tree. Now, when you see the seed of banyan tree, will you not say that the banyan tree is there in seed? Hello?
Can you repeat again, Maharaj?
There is banyan a seed tree? Of banyan tree. Okay. When you see the seed, will you not say that a banyan tree is there in the seed?
Yes. Right. Yes.
It is. Is it just symbolical?
Yes.
No, it is not symbolical.
Sorry. It is the existence itself. Right.
Existence itself. Right. Similarly, the lowest manifestation of Brahman is Om. Okay. That is why Sri Ramakrishna is saying that the Sandhya prayers, they merge into Gayatri. And Gayatri merges into Om. Because Om is the minimal manifestation of Brahman. So it is not just that it is symbolic. This whole world is contained in Om, in that sense also. Because Om signifies all sounds which are there in this world. Sounds signify what? Waves, frequencies. What is there in this world which is not wave? Shubhadeep, are you trying to tell something? No.
No, no.
So you see, now we know that everything is wave, right? Everything is wave. So if everything is wave, sound is nothing but wave. Yeah. And so this is the lowest manifestation of Brahman.
Yes.
That's what we are saying. We know because of wave-particle duality that everything is wave. And if everything is wave, if you want to go to the least or the minutest particle, it can be wave. In fact, it will be wave. And so, Om is this universe in his least manifested form. Okay, just like banyan tree is there in a seed, but seeing the seed, you may think that, and you see this God's creation or the play of nature, that the seed of banyan tree is small. And the tree is so huge. Mango tree's seed is so big. But the tree is not anywhere near banyan tree. But banyan tree is so huge, but the seed is so small. So that means in that small seed, the code for the whole, not only just code, but the entire tree is there in that seed. You have to just kindle it by giving it proper catalyst kind of water, etc. Then it will come up. So similarly, ignorance, when it is in its least in its least form, then it will go to Om. That is why they say when people do sadhana, they will hear anahata dvani, means a sound which is produced without any ahata, without any striking. Sound is always produced when two things come together. But if sound is produced just like that, that is not possible in physics. But it is possible in spirituality. And so that is called anahata dvani. They say from the navel, from nabhi, it comes. So that Om, that sound will come. How that sound come? Because a person who is a spiritual aspirant has done so much of spiritual practices that person has reduced ignorance to such a level that it has gone to the basic level of ignorance. And that is Om. Om is also within ignorance. But it is the most basic. So that is why the Upanishad says, Om iti etad aksharam idam sarvam. All this is Om. This letter Om. And tasya upavyakhyanam. And now what we will do is its explanation. Upavyakhyanam means explanation. Explanation, upavyakhyanam, that which follows this letter, we are going to explain it. The same three words are repeated by Shankaracharya in his commentary. And he says, Vedanta artha sara sangraha bhutam idam prakarana chatushtayam om iti etat aksharam iti adi arabhyate. So he says that Vedanta artha sara sangraha bhutam idam prakarana chatushtayam. What is this text? This text is Vedanta artha sara sangraha bhutam. This text is of the nature of the essence, sara, essence of the meaning of Vedanta. Essence of the meaning of Vedanta. Sara sangraha bhutam. Bhutam does not mean ghost here, or it does not mean the five elements, pancha bhuta. Bhutam here means that it is of this nature. Sangraha bhutam idam. What is that sara sangraha bhutam? What is Vedanta? Vedasya anta Vedanta. The end of Vedas is called Vedanta. Vedas can be broadly classified into three parts. The Samhita, Brahmana and Aranyaka. Samhita contains hymns, prayers. Brahmana contains rituals. And Aranyaka usually contains philosophical portion of Vedas, in which we find Upanishads. So Vedanta also means Vedasya anta. Vedasya antah means, it can, antah word can mean two things. One is the end part and another is the conclusion. So Vedas conclusion of Vedas also is Vedanta. So the crux of Vedanta, the essence of the crux of Vedanta, the essence of the meaning of Vedanta. So meaning of Vedanta is there, of that what is essential, the cream of the meaning of Vedanta is being told here in Prakarana Chatushtaya. That means in four chapters. Prakarana here we have to take it as chapter. And Chatushtaya means four, a group of four. Om iti edat aksharam iti adi arabhyate. Now, this four chapters is not Mandukya Upanishad alone. Four chapters refers to Mandukya Karika. Mandukya Karika. Mandukya Karika has got four chapters. Agama Prakarana, Vaitatya Prakarana, Advaita Prakarana and Alata Shanti Prakarana. Agama Prakarana, Vaitatya Prakarana, Advaita Prakarana and Alata Shanti Prakarana. Now, they are called Prakaranas. So, Shankaracharya also said Prakarana Chatushtaya means four chapters. And these four chapters take into account those mantras of this Upanishad, which we have seen. So, Upanishad itself is a very small Upanishad. Upanishad is a very small Upanishad. But these chapters of the Karika, Mandukya Karika, they are also taken into account. And with that, this Upanishad is also taken into account. The Upanishad itself has only 12 mantras, 12 sentences. Upanishad has only 12 sentences. But the Karika is into four chapters. And Gaudapada, he starts the chapters and in between refers those Upanishadic sentences. It's an interesting way of commenting on the Upanishads. Elsewhere, how do we see Upanishads are commented upon? Every word of the Upanishad is taken and it is explained, etc. But here we see that karikas, that means like verses, they are there in four chapters of Gaudapada, and in between he refers to some Upanishadic verses, and so 12 verses he refers in the beginning itself, and then he goes on writing his karika. So this karika can be taken as an independent work also, though it is a commentary on the Mandukya Upanishad. So he says, Shankaracharya says, that this Prakarna Chatushtayam, this four chapters, they start with Om Iti Etat Aksharam Iti Adi Arabhyate. Iti Adi, Adi means here in the sense of etc. So they start like Om Iti Etat Aksharam Iti Adi Arabhyate. They start like that. Atayeva Na Prithak Sambandha Abhideya Prayojanani Vaktavyani. So, you see, before this, you have to understand that every text in Indian philosophical tradition, every text has something which is called as Anubandha Chatushtaya. Anubandha Chatushtaya. Four characteristics that are necessary in any text. They are Vishaya, Adhikari, Sambandha and Prayojana. Vishaya means subject matter. Adhikari means a person who is qualified to study that subject matter. And Sambandha means the connection between the subject matter and Prayojana, means the object to be attained. So Sambandha is the connection between the subject matter and the Prayojana, and Prayojana, you know, the object of the study. So these four things are there, which are always studied in a philosophical text before starting a text. Particularly in Vedantic tradition, this is followed. And in Advaitic Vedantic tradition, it is definitely followed. But here, Shankaracharya says, Atayeva na prithak sambandha avideya prayojanani vaktavyani. So, that is why here, sambandha avideya prayojanani. Means, here he is not talking about adhikari, that has to be understood. So here separately no discussion is made of the subject and the object of study and also the utility, object of study and also the connection between them. The subject of study, object of study and also the connection. Abhideya here means Vishaya, means subject of study. Sambandha is the connection between the subject of study and the Prayojana or the aim of study. So these things are not here discussed separately. Why? Because Shankaracharya gives Yani eva tu Vedante sambandha abhideya prayojanani tani eva iha bhavitum arhanti. If you have not already purchased the text of Shankaracharya's commentary in Sanskrit of Mandukya Upanishad and Karika, I strongly recommend that you purchase it. It is available from Chaukamba, it is available from Motilal Banarasidas, etc., etc. You will also get it online in open source. Devanagari text of Shankaracharya's commentary on Mandukya Upanishad and Mandukya Karika. Why Devanagari? Because however much you may see the subtitles of a movie, the beauty of the dialogues in original can never be surpassed. Can it be? Never. So however much you may read the translation, there is a adage in English, lost in translation. So many things are lost in translation. First of all, the beauty of Shankaracharya's language. See how simple. He says, yeah, I am not separately discussing the Anubandha Chatushtaya here. Why? Because Yani eva tu Vedante Sambandha Abhideya Prayojanani Tani eva iha bhavitum arhati, arhanti. So whatever is there as subject matter and object of study, and the connection between subject matter and object of study, etc. Again, etc. will here mean the adhikari, a person who is qualified to study. In Vedantas, in general, whenever we study any text of Vedanta in general, whatever would be the subject matter and the object of study, and the connection between the subject matter and object of study, the same thing here also, tani eva, the same thing, iha bhavitum arhanti, here bhavitum arhanti, will be there. So there is no need to separately study the subject and object, because whatever is there as subject and object in Vedanta is there here also. So just to remind you, what is the object of study of Vedanta? The object of study of Vedanta is to understand that the Brahman and Atman are same. Jiva Brahma Aikya, Atma Brahma Aikya, the identity of Atman and Brahman, that is same. And what is the subject matter of study? The subject matter of study are the statements of Vedanta or statements of Upanishads, which tell us that Atman and Brahman are same. That is the subject matter of study. So here Shankaracharya says, because we are going to study Vedanta, we are not going to study something different. So whatever is there in that Vedanta, that only is the object and subject, etc., etc. So we are not going in a discussion separately. So when you study, say, computer science, you have already studied computer science, you have done this programming, that programming, and then when new some technology comes, so then everybody has to go and learn that technology. Then people are not taught again what is computer, what is algorithm. Nobody is taught that all these things are same. Now you just study the syntax and how things are done, like that. Tathapi prakarana vyachikyasuna sankshepato vaktavyani. So in manuals, computers manual, what happened? This is meant for people who have some basic qualification, but still, if somebody is coming without any background, in summary, we are giving what is necessary. So here also Shankaracharya says, tathapi, nonetheless, prakarana vyachikyasuna. Prakarana vyachikyasuna means a person who wants to explain a prakarana or a treatise. Vyachikyasu means vyakyatum ichuk. Vyakyatum ichuk. Vyachikyasa means vyakyatum icha. Means a person who wants to do vyakya. Means a person who wants to do explanation. Vyakhyana means explanation. Anybody who wants to do explanation is vyachikyasu. Like moksha is liberation. Anybody who wants moksha is mumukshu. Pipasa is thirst. Anybody who wants or who is thirsty is pipasu. Jignyasa is inquiry, wanting to know more. The desire to know is jignyasa. Jnatum iccha jignyasa. Anybody who has that desire to know is called jignyasu. Similarly, vyachikyasu means anybody who wants to explain. What? Prakarana vyachikyasu. Anybody who wants to explain a treatise, sankshepato vaktavyani. That person should, in brief, tell what is prayojana, what is sambandha, etc. has to be told. That is what I think. Like that Shankaracharya is telling. So what does it mean? It means that he will now start telling. So Anybody has any questions here? So we will stop it. We will stop it here, this study, and we will continue on. We will continue
next
on 12th of February. 12th of February, we will continue. Okay.
Maharaj, the Brahma Sutra class will be held tomorrow.
Today also it will be there.
Today I won't be able to join.
Yes, today also.
I mean, if it is. Today is from 4 to 5, na?
Okay.
I'll join tomorrow.
1 minute. Om Shanti.
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 Hari Om Tat Sat.
Hari Om Tat Sat.